So we had left off talking about the monohybrid crosses that Mendel had performed, which led to his discovery of the first law of heredity. And now we're going to consider what happens if two character traits are followed simultaneously, which led Mendel to his second law of heredity called the law of independent assortment. So let's look at that right now, and let's look at representative data. So here we are following both P texture, round or wrinkled, and P color, yellow or green. And our allele symbols for these traits are as follows. Large R's signify round P's, small R's signify wrinkled P's, large Y signify yellow P's, and small Y signify green P's. So we take a true breeding plant here that has wrinkled and green P's, and a true breeding plant that has round and yellow peas, and those are crossed. And not surprisingly, the F1 show only one phenotype as for monohybrid crosses, and that is the phenotype shown are yellow peas and round peas. So the round allele is dominant to recessive to wrinkled, and the yellow allele is dominant to green, which is what Mendel had found in his monohybrid crosses for these alleles and traits as well. Now he just as he did for his monohybrid crosses, in these dihybrids, hybrid for two different genes at the same time, heterozygous in other words, for two genes at the same time, the F1 are doubly heterozygous, big R little r, big Y little y. And now we ask ourselves, how is it that these alleles assort into gametes, eggs, or sperm at the time of reproductive cell formation in these F1 individuals? So we allow these F1 individuals to self-hybridize, and they will produce eggs and pollen, sperm, and those will be randomly mixed, and we can determine what the ratios are of various phenotypes that we obtained. Now, what Mendel observed was this, that, for example, in eggs here, in female gametes, if a female gamete acquired, in the production of the female gamete, acquired a large R allele, that could be accompanied by a large Y allele, or it could be accompanied by a small Y allele in equal proportions. And likewise, if an egg had acquired a small R allele, it could either also acquire a large Y allele or a small Y allele. That is to say, the assortment of alleles that govern different character traits is completely independent. There is independent assortment of these as they are segregated into reproductive cells at the time of sex cell formation. Let's consider what would happen if that weren't true. Let's imagine that for some reason, unspecified as of yet, let's say that the large R allele, when it went into a gamete, was always accompanied by a large Y allele and not a little Y allele. In that case, we would only have two types of gametes. We would have large R, large Y gametes, and the reciprocal would be that when little R went into a gamete, only little y would go in, and so we would have little r, little y gametes as well. These would not be present. These genotypes of gametes would not be present in either eggs or sperm. But that is not what Mendel got. Mendel found that there were equal proportions of these four types of gametes, these four genotypes of gametes in equal proportions, and he knew that based on the ratios of phenotypes he obtained in the F2 generation from the random mixing of these gametes, that is self-fertilization and obtaining large numbers. And what he observed was that he had a very particular classic ratio that you've probably all heard of before, and that is a 9-3-3-1 ratio, in which 9/16, the 9/16 proportion of the progeny are doubly dominant, that is, they have the dominant phenotypes, round and yellow. Only 1/16 of the progeny P's were wrinkled and green that had the double recessive phenotypes. 3/16 had the dominant phenotype for pea texture, but the recessive phenotype for color. And another 3/16 had the recessive phenotype for texture and the dominant phenotype for color. And so we can see these different phenotypes here that if you randomly mix these gametes in what would occur in cell fertilization, then look at the resulting genotypes of offspring, you will find that nine of the possible 16 resulting genotypes are going to have a double dominant phenotype because they will carry either one dominant allele for each character trait, or they'll carry two dominant alleles for each character trait. So actually, if you were to look at these 9/16 of the peas that have the double dominant phenotype a little more carefully, you would find that there's only one genotype that actually has both dominant alleles for both character traits, for both pea texture, round, and for pea color, yellow. Whereas the other 8/16 of the progeny, or the other 8/9 of the round yellow progeny, might have two dominant alleles for one trait, but are going to be heterozygous for the other trait. And that is true for the rest of the round yellow progeny. We see that only 1/16 of the progeny will be doubly recessive homozygous, because that would result only when a little r, little y egg was fertilized by a little r, little y pollen or sperm. And we would only that would only represent 1/16 of the progeny. And the 3/16 that have a dominant phenotype for one trait and recessive for the other, and reciprocally for the other 3/16, we can see are made up are constructed by homozygosity for one of the recessive alleles for one trait, and either homozygous dominant for the other alleles governing the other trait, or heterozygous there, because the dominant allele dictates phenotype in the case of a heterozygote. So it was these ratios in his dihybrid crosses that spoke to Mendel, this 9-3-3-1 ratio that he obtained not only with the alleles governing pea texture and pea color, but also with alleles governing other character traits as well, plant height or axial versus terminal flowers, pod texture or pod color. Whenever he looked at the inheritance of alleles that govern two character traits simultaneously and produced dihybrids in the F1, which were allowed to self-fertilize, he always obtained a 9-3-3-1 ratio of phenotypes in his F2 offspring, which told him quite clearly that the alleles of one gene and the alleles of another gene were assorting completely independently into gametes, so that in this dihybrid we should always get four different genotypes of gametes in equal proportions. And that ratio of four different gametes containing double dominant, double recessive, and then recessive for one and dominant allele for the other, and vice versa. Those ratios of genotypes of germ cells, of sex cells, should all be equal. We should have a 1:1:1:1 ratio of those, which would then produce this 9-3-3-1 ratio in the F2 offspring. And in order to have equal proportions of these, the alleles of one gene must be assorting into gametes completely independently of the alleles at another gene. Otherwise, you would not get this. Now, it was extremely fortuitous, as I've already mentioned, that Mendel chose alleles of genes that were located on different chromosomes. Because as we will see, when genes are located on the same chromosome and their alleles are examined in terms of their assortment into gametes, into sex cells, we will see that we will not have independent assortment in that case. So Mendel was either extremely lucky in choosing seven different genes that govern seven different character traits, that all of the genes being found on individual separate chromosomes, or he in some cases examined combinations of alleles that were on the same chromosome and did not get a 9-3-3-1 ratio and did not record that data. We simply don't know the answer to that question. But for now, we'll assume that it was entirely fortuitous. Now, one thing I want to point out before moving on, and that is that if we look at these assortment of alleles into sex cells of the F1 generation, for the moment, just consider the arrangement of these alleles as they were inherited from the two parents that we're examining here. So here, when these round yellow parents produced sex cells, they produced sex cells that carried a big R and a big Y. And likewise, these wrinkled green plants produced sex cells that had a small R and a small Y. So in that sense, we can say small R and small Y and large R and large Y were the parental generation's arrangement of these alleles. And if we look at then the F1, which have result in this genotype by the union of these sex cells, if we look at how the F1 produced sex cells, we can say that in a way, this gamete and this gamete, that is the small R, small Y, and large R, large Y gamete, have the parental arrangements of those alleles as originally inherited from the parental generation here, either in a sex cell that's big R, big Y, or little R and little Y. That is, these two types of gametes have a parental arrangement of those alleles. And we could then consider these to be recombinant, we'll say with an R, in the sense that in the independent assortment of these alleles into gametes, there was a recombination of the parental arrangement of these alleles. Here we have big R with little Y, or little R with big Y, which is not how these alleles were inherited from the two parents here. So here we see we have two parentals and two recombinants in a way. And here we could basically say we have a 1-to-1 ratio of parental arrangements of alleles to recombinant arrangements of alleles. And I'm going to put recombinant in quotes because when we talk about linked genes, we'll talk about recombinants in a very in a more specific fashion. So I'm putting recombinants here in quotations. And you'll notice that we have a 50% then recombination frequency when we're talking about independent assortment. So independent assortment produces, if you will, a 50%, that yields a 50% recombination frequency. And I'm going to put that in quotes, recombination frequency, in the sense that independent assortment shuffles the alleles so that we have two parental genotypes that were inherited from these parents and two recombinant ones. And that's important to remember when we move on to talking about linkage, which is where we're going to move to next. We're going to look at, first of all, we're going to examine sex linkage, the phenomenon of sex linkage, and then we will move on to looking at the recombination between genes on the same chromosome. But before we do either of those things, we're going to talk about the allele's eye or the gene's eye view of Mendelian inheritance. So we're going to look at Mendel's first law and Mendel's second law in terms of a gene's or allele's eye view. And we will see that this leads is basically an explanation of the chromosomal theory of inheritance, which tells us that the Mendelian determinants genes are carried on chromosomes. And we're going to be examining that from an allele's eye or a gene's eye view of the segregation of chromosomes at mitosis and then meiosis. And then we'll move on to sex linkage, and then we'll move on to recombination. So that's where we're headed.